I believe it's 2 foot. And it is. It's 2 foot contours. And I'd like to, you know, use that plan because I really prefer not to have to prepare another plan just for 1 foot contour.
Well, then in that case, if you're going to submit that plan, you'll have to be submitting it as a variance or a request for a variance to our ordinance on that. I don't know. We'd have to take that up at that time.
But what I could do is I could submit that, and I can show the outpiece, you know, which you've mentioned, and I'll also show on there the water course where the culvert is.
Has there been an end run done on this board? It seems to me that if the applicant had a wetland application pending before this board that was unresolved and he has in turn deeded part of his property over and is now being reviewed and in fact has been given a building permit, it seems as though the building inspector is, I don't know. I don't know what the protocol is, but it would, on the surface, appear that the building inspector has overstepped his bounds. He's acted on a piece of property prior to its resolution before this board, and I don't know if that's appropriate or not.
Now, I'll double check that and make sure the board knows.
And are we looking at a different piece of land than what came before the board in October '89?
In terms of the form, that really is the
right.
Property
yeah.
right now.
No,
property
that's the entire issue of whether we go by the current wetlands ordinance, which does include the soils underneath the filled land, or the old wetlands ordinance, which does not, or in a more limited way. Are we looking at the same piece of land that was brought before us in October?
Well, if I could speak on that, I have no intention of coming before this board under the current wetlands alteration provision of the zoning ordinance. So if the board determined that I don't have a pending application and I had to reapply or apply under the new provision, I would not do it. I would abandon it.
Well, I guess what's raised the question here is the actions that have taken been taken to take some outpieces out of this property. What has that done to the application? We don't know at this point in time.
I don't think it's done anything to it except make it a smaller parcel of land. And it's been done with the acquiescence of the building inspector, and I believe the town attorney's been aware of it. There's certainly nothing wrong with it. I mean, the application, this August, it'll be a year since I've been involved in this piece of land. And the purpose in doing it was specifically because of the new wetlands ordinance. A lot of people in the town made transfers and did other things to protect their property rights at that time. And I'm one of them. And I did it not only with this land, but with other land that I owned. And I also represented clients who did the same thing.
I don't think that everyone has a right to protect their property value. And certainly my standpoint isn't to judge whether you did something other than that. It's just, where are we in the process in reviewing this application and under which ordinance are we, current or past, are we to review it? An issue of completeness, Steve, I also would suggest, given the density of the area around this parcel and the sensitivity of wetlands today, certainly in my experience in the past, it's been very valuable because of flags being sabotaged, moved, and all other kinds of things, whether one wants to blame owners or butters. I think oftentimes it's everyone's in there. Kids are playing with them. No one really knows what they're all about. It looks like a supermarket opening sometimes. That it's very helpful to have a surveyor do a meets and bounds of the wetland edge. It protects you in cases any future litigation upon any earth moving that you're permitted to do. It certainly gives you something to fall back against if Army Corps comes in and says that, hey, this wasn't where it was, certainly if the neighbors are concerned. And it gives us something as a board to see on the face of the earth other than flags that aren't going to be there very long or be faded and long gone. That's something that I'd suggest. I don't know if it's required, but I think it's the only way of determining actually where a wetland boundary is.
I assume that the building inspector or somebody would be out there, you know, prior to the time that any grading would be done. And they would know, you know, where the boundary is. The work that's going to be done will be done in one day. So, you know, it isn't something that's going to take a long period of time, and it's something that the building inspector is going to be well aware of where the boundary is, and once the land is sloped, it's there permanently, as far as I'm concerned. But I think the, you know, threshold question for this board is, do I have a pending application? Because if the board decides that I don't, then there's no point in getting into these other issues, as far as I'm concerned. If I do have a pending application, I think I understand what the board wants, and I will supply that to you.
Okay. I think that's a fair summary. Steve, do you have anything else to add to this?
I think at this point, I'll do some research and get back to the board and Mr. Davis on this issue. But I think the question is going to be, when were transfers made, and is Mr. Davis willing to make changes to the application materials so that things are taken out? And we also need to find out how what the current status of the building permits are and how they affect this request for a wetlands alteration permit under the old ordinance.
And I would also suggest that we read the letter from Mr. Leahy, make sure that we understand what points he's making, and if the board disagrees with the attorney, then we should bring that subject up also. But at this time, we have to address the issue of completeness, and do I have a motion that can be made at this point?
Mr. Chairman, one more thing I think, yeah. Steve, on your list was a one-foot contour plan of existing and proposed contours. Is that?
Yes.
Okay.
That is item two.
Okay.
Location and slope of all existing grades to 1 foot contours. We will either need the 1 foot contours or you'll have to make a case for a variance to 2 foot. You understand that?
Well, I understand what you're saying, but I don't understand what the case would be. I have 2 foot contours now, mm-hmm. and I would ask that be accepted.
You're going to be asking for a variance. Okay.
Right, because it's very easy to, you know, 2 feet and 1 foot on a large piece of land like this. Mm-hmm. In fact, the land is substantially level anyway. Most of the slope is on the land that is not fill land and isn't even the subject of, you know, this hearing. Mm-hmm.
Mr. Chairman, I have one final question, and that is, Mr. Davis, I understood you to say that there had been a conveyance of a portion of this parcel. I guess it's the lot that's down in what would be the southeast corner on our map about 5 years ago. That was done prior to the time that you purchased the remaining parcel?
No, it was done after.
But the deed that you've proffered to us is dated April the 1st, 1989.
Well, I'm not sure which... that deed that you have, that's the deed when I purchased a one-half interest. I purchased this land with Philip Willard. We purchased it together. We each owned one-half as tenants in common. And whatever the date is on that deed was the date that I purchased from Mr. Willard his one-half. But if you look at the end of that deed, there'll be a reference which goes back to the original purchase of the land from, I believe, Fred Marola, one of his companies. And that should be 1985. I think it was November. I think actually the deed was dated in October 1985, but the closing and the transfer didn't take place until November 1985.
Well, I guess in order to satisfy, I don't see any particular reference like that, so I suppose that what I would like to request as a planning board member is that you supply us with a copy of the 1985 deed in addition to the 89 deed.
Sure. I'd be glad to do that.
Do I hear a motion from the board on this action, which is once again a completeness application? Should we deem it complete or incomplete?
Mr. Chairman, mm-hmm. Make a motion, be it ordered, that the wetland alteration application, Richard Davis, for wetlands alteration activity on one lot, map U3, Lot 35, I take it that that's the correct parcel of land, in the vicinity of Cottage Branch Road, Woodland Avenue, and Elmwood Road, is deemed to be incomplete in accordance with Section 19.3.9 of the old zoning ordinance and the facts presented.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any further discussion?
I'd only change the name of the road to Woodland Road, not Woodland Avenue.
Woodland Road. So noted. Mr. Esel, do you accept that amendment?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
Seeing that it's correct.
Any other discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor of the motion, please raise their hand. Opposed? Motion is passed unanimous. It is deemed incomplete at this time. So, and do you understand what we're looking for at this point?
I think I do, Mr. Chairman, and I can check with Mr. Butler. I want to get a copy of a letter from Mr. Leahy.
That's right.
But I think the things that you want, I can supply without any problem.
Okay.
Good.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Our next item on the agenda is the item that we had scheduled for 8:55. Michelle Sear, daycare facility for 9 children on 95 Leiden Lane. Site plan review, application completeness once again. Is there an representative of the applicant present? Could you please come up to the microphone and identify yourself?
Hello, I'm Paul Sear, Michelle Sear's husband. She's unable to be here tonight because she's ill, so I'm here to answer any of your questions.
Okay. Once again, normally what we're looking for here is in site plan review is whether your application is complete. It would be helpful, I believe, to have you review for us the history of your application, why you're before us, and we'll go down through the checkoff list, and we've got some questions for you on some items that are deemed partial at this point in time. So maybe you can give us a little history on the daycare center and on the need for expansion at this time.
Okay, this is a home daycare located on Leiden Lane. What Michelle has is a license for 9 children, 7 preschool children and 2 school-age children, which would show up after school. This is an existing daycare, although right now she has only 6 children. We started the daycare, and there was some type of miscommunication with the town hall. we assumed that we could have 6 children without needing any type of permit. That's how we ended up having the existing daycare. We've gone to the, once we realized, well, when we went to go to get a permit for 9 children, we then found out that we were operating wrongfully. So then we then went to go before the zoning board, and we have their approval, and now we're here.
Okay. So you're basically now here kind of to write a situation that maybe was done any knowledge of yours, an error sometime before that.
Yes. It's been in operation for about 2 years now.
Okay. I see we've got some letters in support of your application. Mr. Butler, do you have any other details on this application? Could you go through the review at this point in time as to where this application stands in terms of completeness?
Okay, I can go through the completeness checklist. Before I do that, I just would like to point out, given the other side in terms of letters of support, usually I'm asked whether or not I've heard comments either way, and have just received the letters in support, haven't received any phone calls either way, but haven't received, but particularly of interest to you, haven't received any comments or of concern over the phone. So I would say for the most part, the comments on the checklist are relatively, are in the realm of what I consider to be relatively minor, at least in terms of an existing situation like we have here. The first item deals with building plans and all elevations. It's partial because the applicant didn't provide building elevations for the property. Just provided some sketched-in building plan, site plans, and then they showed the building plan of where the daycare center actually is.
Is it a one-story, two-story house?
Two-story home.
It's a two-story home. It's typical garrison colonial type?
Yeah, it's split level with the basement is a daylight basement.
Okay.
And that's where the daycare is.
Okay. Going down on the second page of the checklist, 8A, The only issue there was that beyond the 100-foot line or so, some of the natural features that were shown started to fade away, so to speak. Again, I'm not sure that's a big issue. They did a pretty good job in terms of showing what was on the site in the general vicinity of the site. But perhaps didn't go quite to the 200-foot standard. Number 9 deals with topography. There wasn't any topography shown. Again, not sure that's a big issue, but in this case, but wasn't shown. Parking on item 10, parking, loading, and unloading area locations. There was information, or you can see on the plans, they showed where the driveways were. In terms of a daycare center facility, there wasn't that much information or in terms of where the children were dropped off and picked up, and sometimes that's provided in terms of, you know, do people pull into the driveway or do they just pull in front of the property, so what's the traffic circulation? So that's minor in terms of completeness, but maybe deals with an issue that the board wants to pursue in terms of how the parents pick up and drop off their children. In terms of 12B and 12C and 12D, again, minor. They weren't addressed by the applicant, but I think we pretty much know in terms of sanitary waste, water, and solid waste storage. We assume that they're using public water, public sewer, and probably bring their trash to the transfer station.
Yes.
Okay. But, again, pretty minor. Landscaping and buffering, they show some information in terms of what's there. They didn't present information in terms of what they're proposing to add. And if they're not proposing to add anything else, then that might be able to stay right there. They didn't go into a lot of detail in terms of the ordinance requirements about botanical names and common names and everything else. But again, may or may not be all that appropriate here. Signage, I had a question mark. Don't know much about signs. Don't know if they have one. Don't know if they're proposing one.
The zoning board required that there be no sign.
Okay. Yeah, that's that. Then evidence of right title or interest. Just same issue. Do they own it? And they don't own it. They've indicated that they rent, I believe.
And we live with her mother.
Okay. But, I mean, so, again, something, there wasn't a deed or anything else or some sort of letter stating that they had the, that the owner of the property agreed with it. But again, given the fact that it's one of the applicant's mothers, again, it may not be a big issue. But so that's the checklist. That's the
to that last point. I think that should be considered a moot point. I think it's something that we should still have a letter or something indicating that there is no problem with this use.
Okay, that's fine.
The many times family members say after the fact, hey, we didn't want that to happen. We don't know that sitting here. You may have great relations with your family, which is wonderful, but we don't have any knowledge of that, and so we need something really that says that the owner has no problem with this.
Okay.
I would draw your attention to the map of the neighborhood where this site is. It's not in an area that's really what I would consider really congested. But you should think about the concept of 9 children being dropped off and picked up. It's kind of on a curve and on a corner. And it would be good to know how that is going to be done or how it is being done, whichever the case may be, from a safety point of view. I guess the other thing is buffering. Did we cover that?
That would be under landscaping buffering plan.
Yeah.
It was marked as being partial. Yeah,
partial. So we would be looking for something in that area to tell us how you're going to buffer. Is there going to be a fence or are you putting shrubs up?
Isn't there a fence around the property?
Is there a fence currently around?
It's in there. 6-foot stockade fence.
Okay. I missed that. So that. I'm sorry, I missed that. And that would answer that question. I guess it would be the board's decision as to whether that's sufficient.
Mr. Chairman, would it be appropriate to ask questions at this point?
Sure.
Are the children restricted to the backyard once they arrive at the house? Do they essentially go through the front door down to the daycare area, and then if they're playing, they're restricted to the fenced-in portion of the yard?
Yes, when the children are outside, they're out back in the fenced-in area. Occasionally, they do go for walks around the neighborhood, but other than that, yes, they're in the back. We have a child of our own who is 6 years old, and occasionally he is in the front yard with his friends. So there are children around the yard, but that's separate from the daycare.
I guess the other comment I had, and I went through the Zoning Board of Appeals hearing. It always is quite a process for people who aren't familiar with it, and as much of a process for those who are somewhat familiar with it. I just need clarification on the point of right title and interest. My assumption was somehow in reviewing that I didn't know what the relationship was with the gentleman here. But I assumed that either they were live-in partners and she had no right title of interest to the house, or if she were married, that her husband had the house entirely in his name, and for some reason there was no common interest through marriage. I'm wondering, I can understand that the Zoning Board of Appeals granted a conditional use that, as I understand, ends with with your wife's, if she chooses to leave the house or if she chooses no longer to run a daycare center, then that conditional use permit expires at that point.
Correct.
What happens with site plan review? Two things, I guess. I have two questions. One, what happens with a site plan review approval? Is it appropriate to grant it to someone who has no right title or interest in the property? And I think from a standpoint, for instance, if we're concerned with health, safety, and welfare, and someone is injured on the property, what recourse do they have to the applicant and all of those other issues, again, borrowing trouble from the future? And the other question was, what has this board reviewed a daycare site plan review application before? And if so, what issues, other than the things that are sort of common sense, are there any other issues that may come from Ernie McVain, for instance, that we should be looking for in terms of health, safety, and welfare? Because you can, I really think of this as in two ways. I think of this as being just a few more kids than were in my house when I grew up, having come from a house with six kids. Yet on the other hand, the potential of having, I believe it's nine children in a household that's meant as a single family residence under daycare supervision, if there's a fire on the property or if there's any other, which it sounds crazy, but that's always the worst case situation that seems to happen. Is there anything that we should be aware of in terms of site plan review unique to daycare centers?
Nothing outside of the basic, you know, some of the particular interesting aspects of daycare. I think, you know, other aspects are, you know, would be taken care of by other departments. And I haven't, when the department heads looked at this, I didn't hear any comments. I didn't know that the fire chief had been on the premises at some point in the recent past and didn't see any problems. But again, in terms of site plan, that would be separate. I think in terms of the question regarding what has the planning board done with other applications, I think the last one, there were two that came up recently. In fact, one was just around the corner on, I forget the name of the road.
Close by.
I think it's officially still part of Leiden. I think it was either lot 32 or 62 or 63. But usually it's questions of buffering from abutters, fencing, adequate fencing, and then issues of traffic circulation, dropping kids off and picking them up again. So those seem to be the ones that come up again and again.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
My only question, in that I don't necessarily understand how granting an approval to a leasehold interest works, and should we be granting the approval to the fee simple owner and the entire?
If I remember,
I don't know. Does it carry with a leasehold interest? What if the leasehold interest goes to a tenant at will, and now you get in?
We have, I think, at least one case which my memory is a little foggy on it, but wasn't the one in this area, but it was the one more in the Oakhurst area, where I believe there was a leasehold interest.
Right.
And could we possibly get that researched?
Sure.
That was a leasehold, remember. I don't remember whether we raised this question, but the question of right title and interest did come up, and I believe the landlord did provide us documentation on that one.
I just can foresee hopefully never would happen, but the liability issues in approving...
Oh, that was a leasehold, and there was right title interest questions, and I believe they were answered adequately.
I, for one, would, at the minimum, would like to see a, some kind of an approval. Something written from her mother saying that she approves of this and consents to it, and probably something that says that she is her tenant and understands that. If you have a written lease, then as a tenant, you do have certain rights that are yours, that are can be separated, but where you have nothing, you have nothing. You have an, a comfortable situation probably, but it really, you know, it is her, your mother-in-law's house, and for us to grant the approval to your wife, or
sure,
we need something. I don't think that would be hard for you to,
no, that's
to get.
Fine. That's not a problem at all.
So. Yeah, we've raised a number of issues. I hope that you you understand where we're unclear on this application and what is incomplete.
Yes, I do.
We will give you written notice of each one of these items that are incomplete. Mr. Butler will work with you on those. So you'll have hopefully a clear idea of what we're looking for, so there won't be a number of back and forths here.
Okay,
do you have any questions of us?
Yes, on the parking question, how elaborate should I go? You know, it's pretty simple. We've got a very large driveway. Everyone pulls into the driveway.
It could be a diagram that shows us its circulation flow. We don't expect that you're going to be parking those cars there all day. What we're interested in is how do the children get dropped off? And what happens to those cars after they drop the children off? What do they do? I mean, do they just pull up to the front of the house, drop the kids off, and then keep on going? I mean, how is it done?
Mm-hmm.
We are envisioning 9 children being dropped off within the space of maybe 5 minutes in the morning. And that, is that
well,
how it's done?
See, it spanned out over a space of 2 or 3 hours.
Okay, so see, that's what I'm talking about. We just don't have a clear understanding of how that works. I automatically assume the worst case, 9 cars in 5 minutes.
So it doesn't necessarily have to be maps and diagrams. I could more or less write it out as in descriptively telling you how it happens.
As long as we understand how it works.
Okay. That's fine, too.
Any other comments from the board?
Steve, are all the letters, the letters of those who aren't objecting, are they all the 2 or 3 immediate abutters?
That I didn't check. You know, some of them are parents who utilize mm-hmm. the daycare.
Why don't I ask him? Have you talked to Lot 24, Lot 15, and Lot?
Let's see.
Lot 16.
I've spoken to everyone,
okay.
And there are a couple of letters from our abutting neighbors. Then. There's one neighbor that we don't have a letter from, but I do have her oral approval, and she said she was willing to provide a letter. I just hadn't gone around to picking it up.
I think that's as important to me as in discussing the issue of buffering. I don't want the applicant to be planting rows of trees that are unnecessary if the, you know, the buffer issue can be with the existing fence. The only other question I had, maybe I'm all out of, I think I may be out of order here, but... the issue of the fence in terms of safety of the children, does a fence have a gate other than going back into the house and through the house? Does one have to go through the house in order to get to the fenced in rear yard?
Oh, no, the fence has 2 gates. I can show
so you can,
one on each side of the house.
So you can exit the yard without going through the house?
Yes, in 2 different
okay.
ways.
Any other questions?
Mr. Chairman, just so it's clear for me when I talk with Mr. or Ms. Sear, in terms of items like the elevations, I mean, can I should the applicant be focusing in on things such as right title interest? I think it's pretty evident.
That's clear.
Yeah, landscaping and buffering to a degree, or is that maybe just going down through some of these? I guess parking, loading, unloading, again, some narrative. Are there any others that like we want more than those 2.
Not for me.
I just think the parking and traffic circulation, anything deals with the safety and the right title and interest.
The greatest impact I can think of, Steve, is the issue of noise. But if the abutters aren't expressing any concern for that, and again, it's almost like having a large family.
Yeah, and if they've been used to this, the fence, and the fence has been adequate, I agree with Tom, the works don't fix it.
Okay, and so everything else next time around will be okay, and then yeah. Mr. and Ms. Sear filled the other two gaps, should be complete. Okay.
Do I hear a motion related to this issue?
I ordered the site plan review.
Application, yeah.
Be it ordered that the request for site plan approval, site plan review application for the Sear Day Care Facility located at 95 Leiden Lane and proposed by
Paul Sear
is deemed to be incomplete in accordance with section 19-2-9 of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented.
Do I hear a second? Any discussion? All those in favor signify by raising their hand. Opposed? We would look for a complete application as soon as you can get something into us.
And the deadline would be?
29th.
29th of June.
You always have to like 29th of June.
That's fine. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We'll hold you here just a little bit longer. Maybe we'll beat our deadline and get out before 10 o'clock. This other business here on the agenda, which Steve and I discussed, and I'd just like to bring up what those are. At our last workshop meeting, there were some infrastructure issues discussed, and I thought some really good ideas. Steve Etzel came up with some ideas, and other people, related to the problem that we're beginning to see develop on some of the feeder roads in the town. And couple of feeder roads that I think that are initially affected by development that we're talking about right away would be Mitchell Road and Scott Dyer, but there would be other roads also affected. And I guess the concept that we're discussing at the workshop, just to refresh your memory, was the concept that we develop some ordinance language that allows us to start to tap the resources of the developers to provide for improved roads that are impacted by their development. And we have a couple situations on Mitchell Road, two as a matter of fact. We have two now on Scott Dyer Road. Those are the two to come to mind immediately. And we will be seeing the town, as much as we may not want to see it happen, we will be seeing the town grow and develop over the next few years. As these feeder roads will now need possibly to be widened, possibly to have sidewalks, possibly streetlights, I mean, signals. Is it something that the town should be supplying, or is this something that we should be tapping the developers for? Open question. And I think what we're looking at right now is the start of a genus of a ordinance change, possibly. But it's something that I'd like to refer to a committee, a small subcommittee, to review, and maybe Mr. Butler can provide us some background in this area from what's done possibly in other areas to work with. But I would like to look to, I don't like to start a subcommittee activity without a goal in sight and an end in sight, because many of these go on forever and ever. What I'd like to do is I'd like to have a committee formed, possibly with three members of the board. And Mr. Etzel, I'd ask you if you would be willing to serve on that committee. I'd like to get two other volunteers. And I don't have to volunteer now, but maybe you could give your name to Steve afterwards if you are interested in working on this. If not, then I may ask you. I'd like to see some research done by Steve and supplied to you. And I'd like to have this item up for a discussion at our next scheduled workshop, which may not be in July. That's another item I want to talk to you about. And with the idea that at that next workshop, we would talk about some ideas, and maybe within 4 months, have a memo worked out of that we could bring back to our regular board meeting at that time to vote on and send on to the town council. That may be too short a period of time, we could always modify it. I'd like to avoid having an issue like, first of all, I would like to have more than one of these issues in front of us, so that we don't get bogged down with a lot of side issues, and I would like to have them disposed of as quickly as possible. So that's the thought process. What do you think? First of all, on the issue, number one, number two, on having this developed through a subcommittee type of activity. Anybody have any thoughts on that?
Something that I, in our practice, been confronted with time and time again, and it really makes it much easier for applicants if they know what the rules are going into it and can negotiate prior to or in the process without, and it also puts the board in a better situation because you're not dealing with exactions and lawsuits. You've got the rules laid out, and it's right there. And I think you're right, the development pressures are increasing, and it's not fair for the town to absorb all of the impacts on new development. I'll also say that I don't necessarily agree that, I think a good example is the applicant here who's to build a single house, and there are 11 other houses existing on the street. I don't think it's necessarily fair to take on, although it may be just the fate that one falls into, to take the last one in and make him pay for everything.
And this is where some advanced planning might be helpful if we had some ideas up front. Would this be something that you'd be willing to work on, Tom?
If associate members of the board are
yes,
you know,
absolutely.
I'd be very happy to, yes.
Okay. Any other comments?
I mentioned at the workshop, one thing I think we might want to consider is, as this is put together and structured, be aware of the same thought process that state DOT is doing along, so that I don't envision working together necessarily, but it would be unfortunate, I think, if the town of Cape Elizabeth did something that was here, and state DOT comes in 6 months and says, I'm here, and you, the poor person who comes into this town, sets of very, very different guidelines. So we can at least be aware of what they're up to. It might help the thought process.
Steve, maybe you could get those for us.
Definitely.
Okay. We have two volunteers. A third person would be nice to make it a committee of three. It's not mandatory. So if somebody else is interested in working out, just let Steve or I know. Steve, would you try to get some materials available for this group to review, maybe in the mail to them so they can have a chance to look at it?
We'll see, maybe after we talk about when would be a good time to aim for a meeting.
That's the next subject I'd like to bring up. Our next scheduled workshop would be right around 4th of July, if not 4th of July. I don't know what's the
third.
July 3rd. July 3rd. I'd like to propose that we skip the workshop in July and aim for an August workshop. Anybody have any violent objections to that? I don't particularly care to do something like July 3rd. I don't know whether we have to.
Do we have anything pending?
Steve, do we have anything that's burning?
We do in terms of, this probably blends into the town planning issues kind of item under the business. It was in the memo that Ivan and I sent out. I think at some point soon, in the past, the planning board has dealt with daycare, and then that kind of dropped by the wayside, and it's kind of interesting it's coming back. I think the issue of affordable housing's another one that was bandied around, and Todd discussed a little bit by the planning board and then dropped because other things came up. I know down the road other things are going to be coming up. A lot of action is going to be stimulated by recent adoption of the comprehensive plan. So there's a lot in there. I'm not sure how the town's going to then follow through on that, if they're going to look to the planning board, look to the town council, or look to some combination of groups and maybe formulate a new committee. That's undecided yet, but I think there's going to be a lot happening over the next month.
I think perhaps you mentioned the comprehensive plan, and we have a number of new members, and I count myself and Judith as new members almost just over a year. All of us, it would be good to take perhaps just a short segment in the next couple of months to sit down and go through the comprehensive plan. It's supposed to be in a document that we're familiar with, and I think we should just brush up on it right from the start. On the affordable housing issue, the last time we met on that, we've met off and on this in the last year, and each time it's the same situation. We get wound up like a clock about the issues, and then we unwind for 2 months, and then we get back up to this, and we never get past that sort of half-wound position. And I don't remember how we left it, but we saw it as a frustration, and we couldn't seem to get beyond a certain point with affordable housing.
I think how we left it last time is we got up to a point, I think, and then last time it was discussed, Dick Tinsman was acting as chair, and we had scheduled it for a meeting, and he had asked me to come up with a memo that listed off a lot of the issues that the town would, the planning board would have to look at to get to a regulatory sort of approach. And that was put at the end of a workshop 2-3 months ago, and because there are other application-related items on there, we never reached it. The planning board, you know, table because things were getting late. And then past workshop or two, they've just been chock full with development review-related items. So again, it was kind of scheduled, didn't happen, and then you had a busy docket. Things wind down a little bit. If they do, it might be the time to bring it back on at some point.
Let me make a suggestion on the affordable issue one. Why don't we bring our workshop in August on to bear on two issues? That one, affordable housing, because I think that is one that we've kind of dropped the ball on, and this one on infrastructure, if we can get something done by then. And then do the daycare in September, possibly. So we'll now be looking at workshops scheduled with topics scheduled all through September. There's a little chance to think about them, get some information in advance, and maybe formulate some thoughts on them.
I'd like to just add to that, and I certainly would like to see affordable housing brought to the August workshop, but I think if we could just focus on how we're going to handle it.
Okay.
Not all the new issues and what are we going to do, but how are we going to actually get to point A, and if our dictate is to come up with some type of suggestion for affordable housing, how we get there so we don't keep backsliding between each.
In other words, are we going to be talking about some kind of density modification? Do we have a plan?
Summarize the plan as much as anything else. Get that fine.
Just so you know, it may not influence discussion all that much, but I won't be able to be on vacation at that August meeting. So on that Tuesday,
August.
But you can still, I can get you all set up so you can have a good discussion regarding.
Okay.
What is the date of the next planning board meeting?
Next planning board will be July
17.
17. And then the workshop we're talking about will be August 7th. If we schedule that for August 14th, would that mean you'd be able to be present?
I believe so.
What problems does that create in town hall if we do a workshop on the 14th instead of the 7th?
I could check. I mean, as long as we get it. And I'm not sure. At the top of my head, I don't know what the regular meeting schedule is. Summer's probably.
I'm also on vacation on the 7th.
You're on vacation on the 7th also?
Scheduled for that.
How does the board feel about the workshop on the 14th and our regular planning board meeting on the 21st? Why don't we go? I'd kind of like to have you there, Steve. I think if we're going to get started on some of these issues, it's going to be tough to carry forward. We could probably have a decent discussion, but you're going to be critical to carrying forward what comes out of that discussion. So, we'll modify ourselves to the 14th for our workshop on the August 14th and 21st for the meeting. Does that cover the item that you had under town planning issues?
Yes, I've had a couple other items.
Yeah, the only other thing I have on that is I have not been contacted by either school board representative or town council as yet on the issue of planning for the campus and the school's problems with continual temporary classrooms. Have you heard anything on that issue, Steve?
Yes, no. That memo went out just recently. But what happened was that before the memo went out, the last town council meeting, they actually set up a committee to deal with the issue.
Okay.
And so the way I understood it was that there was going to be two representatives from the school board, two representatives from the town council, and I think that was it. I raised the issue to the town council chairperson that was an issue that
the planning
probably a planning board had come up with originally, and the memo was coming, that perhaps there might be some interest to have some planning board involvement, and I'm not sure how that ended up.
If they don't want us, they don't want us. Can I say? At least if they're thinking about the planning, we've accomplished something.
They're thinking about it, definitely.
Okay. Any other items, Steve?
Couple other, just I don't know if Ivan, if you want to read in the two items of correspondence that came in as you were reading them, we can maybe say that to very last. The other issue that it's related on First Atlantic project, the neighbors asked me to let the planning board know. I'm assuming that First Atlantic Corp will notify us soon that they've arranged that meeting between the neighborhood, Atlantic, and Elizabeth Heights.
Because Dick Tinsman asked me about that. Okay. So it has not taken place yet.
Hasn't taken place. The schedule that was told to me by one of the representatives of the neighborhood was Wednesday, July 11th. So they asked me to pass it on to you.
Okay.
So, again, I think in the Cape Courier they had the previously scheduled meeting on the calendar, so that was, I assume, was erroneous.
Where
I believe it's in Town Hall, probably down the cafeteria. Again, I'm assuming where I'm going to get a notice soon, and as soon as I get it, I'll let you all know.
Okay.
That was the issue I wanted to let you know about, then there's correspondence. And Mr. Chairman, deal with it.
Yeah.
Both on the Elizabeth Heights project.
I'm going to make a note of that meeting on my calendar. I'll never have it. That's Wednesday, July 11th. Huh? Two other items of correspondence that were received tonight, dated June 18th, through the planning board from Nancy Kennedy. Looks like it concerns Elizabeth Heights. And from Barbara, would you say that's Brigham or Brigham?
Brigham,
I guess. Brigham, and we're guessing. Also dated June 18th, also concerning Elizabeth Heights. These items of correspondence will be copied and transmitted in our next packet.
What I usually do is if they're targeted for a specific project, I would include all that with the application. So okay. If the First Atlantic does come in for July, all that correspondence will be included.
Speaking of things to be included, the new information from Sterling Woods is in, but not forwarded to. We will be receiving that for the next
one. And we'll have staff review.
Yes. Yes. And there's been some staff review. And in the letter that Mr. Drinan wrote, he asked that certain things be reviewed. That's being done as we speak. As I told Mr. Etzel, one piece of information was submitted by the deadline. Two others weren't. When I talked to Ed Drinan over the phone, I thought that everything was going to be held to the July meeting. So I sent out just this one letter and then saw that he was asking that the two concept plans be included. They are all here. They'll be sent out in July.
I have nothing else. Do any of the planning board members have anything else? If not, do I hear entertain a motion to adjourn?
I so move.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you, and good night. Good meeting.